Alright, so let me go through the first two questions once again, since many people weren't there at that time. The first question basically says that given two vectors a and b, you have to find the magnitude of the difference, magnitude of a minus b. So this is pretty simple. You subtract the components and then you calculate the mod square of this particular thing and take a square root, so that the answer is 11.53. Second question says that what is the projection of the vector a along the y direction, basically projection of a along a y cap. So this is basically the y component of a, which is equal to 3. So this is the answer. Third question says that at the Cartesian point P, which is equal to 3, 4, 1, which of the following statement is correct about the cylindrical coordinate system? So at the point 3, 4, 1, the radius of the circle, which is rho, is basically root over 3 square plus 4 square, because in cylindrical coordinates rho represents the radius of the circle which is projected on the xy plane. So here rho is equal to 5. So the correct option is rho equal to 5, which is option A. Similarly in the... Yes, hello? Any question? Okay. In question 4, the question is that two point charges q1 equal to minus 5 microcoulomb and q2 equal to plus 2 microcoulomb are placed at 3, 2, 1 and minus 4, 0, 6 respectively. Then what is the force on q1 due to q2? And the four options are given as repulsive and directed in xyz direction, repulsive and directed in x direction only, attractive and directed in xy direction, and attractive and directed in only in y direction. So you see over here, charges q1 and q2 have opposite signs. So that should tell you that the force between them has to be attractive because the charges are opposite. And secondly, this vector r, which is the separation vector between q1 and q2, r is given by the difference between the coordinates of q1 and q2, which is minus 7ax, minus 2ay, plus 5az. So you see that r has an x component and a y component and a z component. So it is directed in all three directions basically. So the correct option would be that it is attractive, the force is attractive and directed in the xyz direction, which is option C. Okay, question number 5. It states that the electric field intensity due to a point charge Q is, and the four options are outward radially directed, magnitude proportional to charge and inversely proportional to square of distance, inward directed, magnitude proportional to charge, inversely proportional to square of distance, outward directed, magnitude proportional to charge and distance, and inward radially directed, magnitude proportional to charge and distance. Okay, so if you are given a point charge Q and suppose the charge Q is positive, then the electric field is always directed away from it radially, as shown by the arrows over here. Okay, and the value of the electric field is given by this formula, 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q by r square, where q is the charge, r is the distance from the charge, and epsilon naught is the permittivity of free space, given that the charge is in free space. So in that case, the correct option would be that the force, that the electric field due to the charge q, is outward radially directed, it is proportional to the magnitude of the charge, and inversely proportional to the square of the distance from the charge. So the correct option is in this case option A. Alright. Any doubts till now or any questions? Okay, if there are none, then I proceed to question 6. Question 6, you have to find basically the angle between vectors A and B in degree. So A is given by this particular vector here and B is given by this vector here. So if theta is the angle between A and B, then we know that the dot product of A and B, A dot B, is equal to magnitude A into magnitude B into cos theta. From that you can find cos theta as A dot B by magnitude A into magnitude B, and if you calculate, then theta comes equal to 83.73 degrees. Question 7 says that the vector A is given by y into ax cap plus x plus z into ay cap, and the point P is given by minus 2, 6 and 3 in the Cartesian coordinate system. Then you have to find the vector A at point P in terms of the cylindrical coordinates. Okay. So in cylindrical coordinates, vector A can be written in this particular form, A rho into small a rho cap plus a5 into small a phi cap plus az into small a z cap, where the small a rho, small a phi and small a z are the unit vectors in cylindrical coordinates, and capital A rho, capital A phi and capital A z are the components of the vector A in the respective directions. Now using this coordinate transformation matrix, which is given over here, you can actually find the components A rho, A phi and A z in terms of those given in the Cartesian coordinates, basically y, x plus z and 0 being the three components of A in the Cartesian coordinates. So then you can calculate A rho, A phi and A z from this equation, and you have y, x and z over here. Now in cylindrical coordinates, you know that x is given by rho into cos phi and y is given by rho into sin phi. So you substitute these values of x and y, and z stays the same. So then you get A rho is basically rho into sin phi cos phi plus rho into cos phi plus z into sin phi, and similarly A phi is minus rho sin square phi plus rho cos phi plus z into cos phi. Okay. Now at the point P, this rho vector is basically given by root over of 6 square plus 2 square, basically root of x square plus y square, which is root of 40. And the angle phi is given as tan inverse of y by x. Y is 6 and x is minus 2. So this is equal to tan inverse of minus 3 and z is equal to 3. So from this particular values, basically from point for minus 263, this point P, you can find the sine of phi as well as the cos of phi similarly. By doing sine of phi is basically y by root over of x square plus y square, and cos phi is basically x by root over x square plus y square, and then you get these values. Now if you substitute these values into the expressions for A rho and A phi, you finally get these values of the components, and so your final answer of vector A in cylindrical polar coordinates should come to this. So this is your final answer, and this is a option, which option is this? This one is option D, the last option. Okay. Now in question 8. Question 8, you are given two point charges Q1 and Q2 located at 120 and 200 respectively. Now if the total force on a test charge at the point P given by minus 110 has no y component, then you have to find the relationship between Q1 and Q2. Okay, so the diagram is as given. Yes, any question? Okay. So the diagram is given over here. So Q1 is placed over here at 120. Q2 is placed over here at 200 and the point P is over here. So let us suppose that R1 is the vector from point Q1 to P and R2 is the vector from a charge Q2 to P. So then R1 is given over here in this manner and R2 can be calculated in this manner and is given over here. Now you have to find the net electric field at point P due to Q1 and Q2. Okay. So the net electric field at point P is basically the sum of the electric field due to Q1 and Q2. So let us denote the electric field due to Q1 as E1, which is given by 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q1 by R1 square into vector R by magnitude of vector R1. So this is basically this is the unit vector in the direction of R1. So this is the electric field given at point P due to Q1. And using the values of the components of the vector R and the value, you can calculate the distance R1, that is magnitude R1, and then it finally comes to this. Similarly, you can find the electric field at point P due to charge Q2, which is given by vector E2 over here, and the final expression is this. Now, the total field at the point P is basically sum of E1 and E2, that is E1 plus E2. Now E1 can be written in this particular form, E1x into ax cap plus E1y into ay cap, and similarly E2 can be written in this form, E2x into ax cap plus E2y into ay cap. Now for the net field, that is E1 plus E2 to have no y component, the requirement is that E1y plus E2y should be equal to 0, so that the net electric field has 0 y component. That means E1y should be equal to minus E2y, and if I use this particular condition, then from E1, from the expressions of E1 and E2 over here, I obtained Q2 is equal to 2 root 2 into Q1. So this is the condition that Q1 and Q2 need to satisfy in order for the electric field at point P to have 0 y component. Okay. So any doubts in this question? Yes, maybe no, something. All right. Tushar Gupta wants to repeat question 6. Fine. Okay. Where was question 6? Okay, question 6 is basically you're given vectors A and B, and you have to find the angle between A and B. Okay. Now we know that the dot product of two vectors A and B, that is A dot B, is given by magnitude A into magnitude B into cos theta, where theta is the angle between A and B, right? So in that case, you can find cos theta from by basically taking this to the left hand side, and then cos theta is equal to A dot B by magnitude A into magnitude B. So A dot B is basically 3 into 2 minus 4 into 5. There is no x component, so basically it is 4 into 2 minus 5 into 1. So you have x 8 minus 5 in the numerator, and in the denominator you have the magnitude of the two vectors, and then this boils down to 0.1093, that is equal to cos theta, and so then theta is equal to cos inverse of 0.1093. So from that you can find theta is equal to 83.73 degrees. So is that okay? Okay. All right. Okay. All right. So I discussed question 8. Now moving on to question 9. So what does question 9 say? Question 9 states that there are 5 identical point charges of 15 microcoulomb each located at the center and the corners of a square defined by minus 1 less than xy less than 1 and z equal to 0. And you have to find the force on the 10 coulomb point charge which is located at 002. So this square is basically a square which is located on the xy plane, that is z equal to 0, and it extends from minus 1 to plus 1. So basically it is the square is a square of side equal to 2 units, and its center is at the origin, and the edges of the square are at basically xy equal to 1, 1, minus 1, minus 1, 1, minus 1, and minus 1, 1. So these are basically the corners of the square. So you can see there are the charges Q1, Q2, Q3, and Q4 placed at... you guys can see my screen, right? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Okay, okay. Alright. So the first question in this assignment which I prepared is this one. Question 1. Given vectors A and B, what is the magnitude of A minus B? So I guess that is simple. Basically, you have to find take the difference and then find the magnitude. So the correct option is here. The solution is here. It is 11.53. Second question is, given vector A, what is the projection of the vector A along AY cap? Basically, this is the Y component of vector A, which is equal to 3. So the correct answer is 3. Now third question. At the Cartesian coordinate point P equal to 3, 4, 1, which of the following statement is correct about cylindrical coordinate system? Now we know that the radius of the cylindrical coordinate system, which is rho, is basically root over of x square plus y square. So x is 3 and y is 4. So the correct answer is option A, which is rho equal to 5. Alright. So the fourth question is that there are two point charges Q1 and Q2 having values of minus 5 microcoulomb and 2 microcoulomb. They are placed at 3, 2, 1 and minus 4, 0, 6. So what is the force on Q1 due to Q2? Now at first glance you can see that since Q1 and Q2 have opposite signs, so the force between them should always be attractive because the force will have a minus sign between them. And secondly, the vector between Q1 and Q2 is basically the vector from this point 3, 2, 1 to minus 4, 0, 6. So this vector is basically given over here. by this particular value are equal to this. Now this has both the x component is non-zero, y component is non-zero, as well as the z component is also non-zero. So it is directed in all three directions. So here the correct answer will be the force between the charges is attractive and directed in the x, y and z direction. Okay, question 5. What is the electric field intensity due to a point charge Q? Now due to a point charge Q, if the charge Q is positive, then the electric field lines, they will be directed radially outwards from the charge like this. So firstly, the force electric field should be radially outward from Q. Secondly, its magnitude should be proportional to the charge Q and inversely proportional to the square of the distance from the charge, which is R square. So the correct option here will be that the electric field is outward radially directed, magnitude proportional to the charge, and it is inversely proportional to the square of the distance. So the correct option is A. Question number 6. What is the angle between the vectors A and B? So we know that A dot B is equal to A into B into cos theta. From that we can find cos theta in this way, and then theta can be given by this particular form. Alright, in question 7 is similar to what we had seen in this assignment which you had sent. That is, vector A is given by y into x cap plus x plus z into y cap at the point, but and at the point P is given in Cartesian coordinate system. So you have to basically find the vector A at the point P. So what we do is that we write the vector A in the cylindrical coordinate system in this particular form, that is A rho into A rho cap plus capital A phi into A phi cap plus capital A z into A z cap, and the these components, they can be written in terms of those given in the Cartesian coordinates with the help of this transformation matrix. So then you can find A rho, A phi and A z from this matrix equation, and then A rho and A phi is given over here while A z is equal to 0. Now we know that in cylindrical coordinates, x is equal to rho cos phi and y is equal to rho sin phi. So you can substitute the expressions of x and y accordingly, and z stays equal to z only. Then you get A rho is given by this particular expression, and A phi is then given by this expression. Now we were given that the point P is equal to minus 2, 6 and 3. So at point P, the radial vector, that is rho, the radial distance is basically root over of 6 square plus 2 square, which is square root of 40. The angle phi is basically tan inverse of y by x, where y is 6 and x is minus 2. So this is tan inverse of minus 3 and z is equal to 3. So from this point P, you can also find the values of sine phi and cos phi which you need over here. So sine phi is basically given by y by root over x square plus y square, which is 6 by root 40. And cos phi is basically x by root over of x square plus y square, which is minus 2 by root 40. So if you substitute cos phi, sin phi and rho and z in this expression for A rho and A phi, then you can get the final answer. So where A rho is equal to minus 9.9487 and A phi is equal to minus 6.008, and so this is the answer. So the correct answer here is option D. So this question is clear, right? So because you had a similar question in the assignment.
Yes, sir.
Okay, all right. So question number 8, it says that two point charges are located at 1, 2, 0 and 2, 0, 0 respectively. Now if I'm given a point, a test charge at P equal to minus 1, 1, 0, and I claim that the electric field at that point should have no y component, then what should be the relationship between Q1 and Q2? So always if I draw a diagram, then things get easier. So my diagram looks like this over here. Here I have charge Q1 which is placed at 1, 2, 0. Here I have charge Q2 which is placed at 2, 0, 0. And the point P is given over here. Now I have to basically find the force electric field at this point P due to the two charges Q1 and Q2. Okay, so let us suppose that R1 is the vector from Q1 to P and R2 is the vector from Q2 to P. So then R1 is given by this expression, R2 is given by this expression. Then the electric field at the point P due to Q1, we denote that as E1. So E1 is given by this expression, 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q1 by R square into the unit vector in the direction of R1. So this is the unit vector in the direction of R1. So then we get this expression for E1. Similarly, we can find E2. which is the electric field at point P due to charge Q2, and E2 is given over here. Now the net electric field at point P is basically the sum of the field due to Q1 and Q2, that is E1 plus E2. So we can write E1 in the form of E1x into x cap plus E1y into ey cap, and E2 can be written as E2x into x cap plus E2y into ey cap. So now if the total field, that is E1 plus E2, has to have no y component at point P, then the condition is that E1y plus E2y should be equal to 0, or in other words, E1y should be equal to minus of E2y. So if we substitute the expressions for E1y and E2y from the expressions of E1 and E2, we finally get the relationship between the charges Q1 and Q2. That is, Q2 should be equal to 2 into root over 2 into Q1. So is this clear?
Okay.
All right. Okay. Now moving on to the next question. We have 5 identical charges of 15 microcoulomb located at the center and corners of a square defined by minus y less than x y less than 1 and z equal to 0. The force on the 10 microcoulomb charge at point 0,0,2 should be what then? So the picture looks like this. We have 4 charges at the 4 corners of the square located. So the square is on the xy plane, and the extent of the square is from minus 1 to plus 1 in both the x and y directions. So this is basically the square. Each side is equal to 2 units. It extends from minus 1 to plus 1 in the y direction, minus 1 to plus 1 in the x direction. And these are the charges Q1, Q2, Q3 and Q4 located at the corners of the square. And Q5 is located at the center of the square, which also happens to be the origin. So the coordinates of Q1 and Q2 have been shown over here. Now my test charge Qp is located at 0,0,2, which is along this z axis over here. So I have to find the force on the charge Qp due to all the charges Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4 and Q5. The force on Qp due to Q1 is basically 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q1 Qp divided by the square of the distance from Q1 to Qp, which is 2 plus 2 square into the unit vector. So if you do the calculations, then you get this value for the force due to Q1 on Qp. Similarly, one can find the forces F2, F3, F4 and F5 for the different charges at the point Qp. And we get these expressions after doing the calculations correctly. So then the net force on Qp is basically the sum of all these forces F1, F2, F3, F4 and F5. And then if we do the summation, we get this particular value for the net force F. So this is answer A, option A. So is the way of proceeding with this question clear to everybody? Yes, any doubt? Should I repeat it once more?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So basically you are given...
It's clear, sir.
It's clear? Okay. All right then.
Yes, sir.
All right. Okay. So once you find the force, the last question is simply you have to find the electric field intensity at this point. So electric field is basically force divided by the charge Qp. So you divide F by Qp and you get the value of the electric field at that point. I guess if there aren't any further questions, then we can leave the meeting for the time being and then join next week at the same time, same place.
Okay, sir.
All right, then.
Thank you.
All right. Thanks, guys.
Thank you, sir.